Good morning, colleagues. Good morning to members of the media who are here with us this morning. And good morning to all of you who are joining us virtually. This morning, I am joined by Dr. Leon Schreiber, who is our shadow minister, who's been driving the particular issue around cadre deployment and trying to end this practice in government. I'm also joined by Advocate Glynnis Breytenbach, who's also been somebody who's very active in our justice portfolio. And so this is how we are going to be dividing the labour this morning. I will have some opening remarks. I'll hand over to Advocate Breytenbach, and then I'll hand over to Dr. Leon Schreiber, who will take us through essentially what are some of the key nuggets that are coming out of these minutes contained in the Zondo Commission report. And then we will open to the floor for questions and answers. I will take some questions from the media houses that are here, but I'll also be taking some questions via our online platform to be able to answer questions for those members of the media who are not here with us. Thank you very much for joining the DA's press conference. In this press conference, we're going to be specifically looking at the ANC's cadre deployment policy. We've now seen the publication of the minutes of the ANC's deployment committee. And so we want to map out to you exactly what are some of the key things that are contained there, which is what Leon will be doing, and also what are some of the key action steps that we will be taking following the publication of those minutes. Dr. Schreiber has been driving this issue and has uncovered the minutes of the ANC Deployment Committee. And through this process, we have seen how deep the rot goes, not only in the public service, but also we've seen that this has actually been the foundation of state capture in South Africa. We've also seen that this has effectively undermined whatever fight we may have had against corruption, because this has actually been the policy of cadre deployment has actually been the foundation of what is state capture and the kind of corruption that we have seen. Glynnis will be also outlining the process that we can expect going forward with the Commission's reports and what actions are going to be available not only just to the DA but to members of the public and this current status of the reports. She'll also be touching on the NPA's capacity in this regard and taking us over there. In my capacity as a Deputy Chief Whip, I'll be ensuring that the end cadre deployment bill, which is currently before Parliament, is prioritised in the Programming Committee. The DA has proposed a private member's bill called the End Cadre Deployment Bill, and that bill has been introduced in Parliament but must still go to the Public Service Committee. We will be making sure that that is prioritized so that we can make sure that Parliament is dealing with this matter as soon as possible. Our view is that if we can get legislation that can put an end to this practice, we can start to see the undoing of the kind of culture we have seen taking root in South Africa in the public service. In addition, and perhaps more importantly, I will be today writing to the Speaker of the National Assembly, Siviwe Gwarube MP, to request that a debate of public importance be scheduled as soon as possible in accordance to Rule 131 of the National Assembly Rules. The reason being is that it's very important that Parliament does not become a passive spectator in the country while all of these things are happening. While we've got these reports, Parliament now must be seized with making sure that accountability is brought on, and that we must be seized with making sure that we find solutions to fixing some of these problems. And Parliament is best placed to do that. We have seen a hollowing out of Parliament over the past decade, and now we must make sure that we put Parliament at the center of the people's business. And we can do that. If the Speaker can accede to our request, as the DA, we were putting proposals ahead to say how can we end this kind of practice in our public service, and how can we make sure that we start to have real tangible solutions to ending corruption in South Africa. We've long held that the business of Parliament cannot be stalled by the fire that we have seen in Parliament, but instead we need to essentially really ramp up our efforts to make sure that the business of Parliament is continued. So I'm going to hand over now to Advocate Breytenbach so that she can make some inputs with regards to the reports that we have seen.
Thank you. Thank you, Siviwe, and good morning to everybody. Just briefly, the Zondo Commission report has come out now at the end of December. It is an interim report, and one must bear in mind that that means that it's, you know, definitely not a final report. We're expecting another report at the end of January, which will also be an interim report, and then of course the final report at the end of February, which is something that we should be looking forward to. So this first interim report deals reasonably superficially with one or two aspects of the Commission, but one must bear in mind that the Commission says they have received almost 2 million pages worth of information, so very difficult to encapsulate it in a report of 800 pages, so this, which is what this interim report is. It highlights issues that of course should be attended to, particularly with regards to the state-owned enterprises. But it would be impossible to encourage litigation, for instance, or prosecutions based on this interim report, because that's exactly what it is, and it would be premature. So one needs to wait for, one hopes, a more detailed report at the end of January, and that the final report then touches on the major issues in a lot more depth, and then makes very substantive recommendations. Having said that, the Zondo report does make a finding that the National Prosecuting Authority has failed to prosecute state capture, and that they are perhaps not in a position to do so. There are various reasons for this finding by the Zondo Commission, and of course we've seen that over the years, that nothing has happened. State capture cases are not being prosecuted. There is no one at this point in court, and certainly not even one person has gone to jail for these massive criminal enterprises that have been run around the country. So one should ask why that is, and of course the NPA's incapacity is directly related to cadre deployment. The NPA has been hollowed out, it's been decimated, and there are, you know, with regards to political interference in the NPA, and of course with political appointments. For instance, Menzi Simelane was sent there to really destroy the capacity of the NPA. He did an excellent job, and the Democratic Alliance litigated to have him removed and won. It was the court found that his appointment was irrational, and his appointment was set aside. Of course, he was replaced by Nonkobo Jiwa, or one needs to look no further than that for a perfect example of cadre deployment. And then of course we had Sean Abrams, or Sean the Sheep, who is also, you know, a prime candidate for cadre deployment. So we've seen what appointments like that can do to an institution like the NPA. Similarly, you know, the appointment of Tom Moyane at the Revenue Services did the same thing, hollowed out any kind of investigative or accountability-driven capacity. And of course, that was the idea. So the cadre deployment policies of the ANC have been exceptionally damaging to very important institutions like the National Prosecuting Authority, the South African Police Services, the Department of Correctional Services, and the Revenue Services. And we live with that damage every single day. Needs to be rebuilt. That will take a lot of time, a lot of money, a lot of effort, and really they all need to go back really to basics. And in the interim, and while that's happening, you know, we really shouldn't be expected to wait for prosecutions to happen. And so the Democratic Alliance is busy drafting legislation to promote a new Chapter 9 institution, an anti-corruption commission, which would be formed along the lines of the Director of Special Operations, or the Scorpions, but in the manner suggested by the Glenister suite of cases, which would give it complete independence, complete security of tenure, take it out of all of those institutions, the National Prosecuting Authority, the South African Police, and place it alone, a standalone organisation that reports directly to Parliament with its own budget, which will give it the capacity to investigate corruption effectively and efficiently, and to prosecute it effectively and efficiently. And that will be, in our view, a great assistance to the National Prosecuting Authority. We honestly can't be expected to prosecute every single case that comes its way And certainly is in no position to prosecute every single case that will arise from the Zondo Commission. So I'll hand over to Leon Schreiber to carry on with the cadre deployment committee.
Right, good morning everyone. Thank you for joining us today. What I will be doing is to delve a bit deeper and to share the DA's analysis of what is actually contained in the ANC's cadre deployment minutes. For a long time, we've known that this committee exists, but we've never actually seen exactly what it does and exactly how far its tentacles actually reach. So there are 9 points I will make today. The first one is that the ANC's cadre deployment committee is active and it usually meets about once a month. In the past 3 years, it has influenced appointments to 88 state entities involving 29 ministers and deputy ministers. It does not only recommend, but it directly influences and interferes in public sector appointments across a wide spectrum of state institutions, including the courts, state-owned enterprises, Chapter 9 institutions, and government departments. Its influence also penetrates deep into the state, as far as the Deputy Director General level. The cadre deployment committee, as seen in these minutes, uses two primary mechanisms through which it makes and influences appointments. The first is to instruct ministers on specific names of people to appoint, but the second is to actually divide appointments between the minister and reserving certain appointments for the cadre deployment committee. You see this most obviously when it comes to the boards of state-owned enterprises. It is not only ministers who account to the cadre deployment committee. We now have evidence that public servants, who are supposed to be non-political appointments, also account to the cadre deployment committee, and I'll be sharing that evidence with you today. Support, membership, and loyalty to the ANC is a key criteria for appointment. The deployment committee may also discriminate in some cases on the basis of race, gender, and other identity markers when influencing appointments. The deployment committee further manages a separate CV database to give ANC cadres an inside track to appointment. And finally, the existence of provincial and regional deployment committees is also confirmed in these minutes, and it means that the network of capture does not only exist at national level, but is actually extended into provinces and municipalities. That is what I will be showing you today. Briefly, the background here is that the DA wrote to the State Capture Commission in early 2019 following evidence delivered by former Minister Barbara Hogan, where she honestly confronted the practice of cadre deployment. And at that stage, we requested that the Commission seriously investigate cadre deployment as the foundation of state capture. In February 2021, the DA submitted a PIA request to the ANC to obtain these minutes. The ANC refused to share these minutes with the DA. We took them to court and that case is still pending. However, in the meantime, we also wrote to the State Capture Commission and asked them to subpoena these very same minutes because we believe that these minutes are critical to understanding state capture. The Zondo Commission did that, and in August 2021, when myself and DA leader John Steenhuisen attended the testimony delivered by President Ramaphosa, we saw that the Commission had obtained these minutes. We believe that these minutes are in the public interest, and so we submitted a PIA request also to the State Capture Commission. And it is on the basis of that request that the minutes have now been made public. Briefly on the legal framework, the Constitution makes it very clear that in a very limited set of circumstances, appointments to public administration on the basis of policy considerations is allowed. But these appointments are strictly regulated by Section 12A of the Public Service Act, and it is a very, very small group of advisers that ministers may appoint. But when it comes to directors, generals, and officials in the department, those may not be based on political considerations and influenced certainly by a political party. So, what have we found? The first thing is that we know who the members are of the Cadre Deployment Committee. It usually has 11 members, but we see from the minutes that sometimes you have other people attending or standing in for certain members. But on the screen now, you have all the members of the ANC Cadre Deployment Committee as listed in the party's own minutes. We also know that the cadre deployment committee is an active committee. There have been suggestions that it's not very active or doesn't really work. That is incorrect. As you can see from the minutes there, its aim is to meet every fortnight on a Friday. And in reality, if you go through the minutes, you see the ANC's cadre deployment committee usually meets about once a month. So, what mechanisms does the ANC use to actually influence appointments? The first one, and you can see two examples here, is to recommend specific names and say, in this case, a specific comrade is appointed as the deputy chair. Then you also see a second example there, of course, from influence into judicial appointments, where specific names of judges in different courts are also listed. But there's a second mechanism, and this is new, we didn't know about this, whereby the committee runs a form of job reservation and actually reserves certain seats on entities for itself while, quote unquote, allowing the relevant minister or executive authority to fill the other seats. You see two examples here, the one being from the Transnet board, where Minister Pravin Gordhan would fill six seats and the committee would fill the other six of this 12-member board. You also see the example from Safcol, which is the forestry company, where there are 10 members of the board or non-executive directors. The deployment committee provides four names, the minister provides six names. How wide does this go? If you look at these minutes, which cover a period of exactly 3 years, from May 2018 until May 2021, you see that the National Cadre Deployment Committee, the influence of that committee extends throughout every sphere of our state. It is an insidious institution. It was involved in the appointment of officials to 88 different national government departments, state-owned enterprises and agencies, at least 29 deputy ministers and deputy ministers, as well as the president, appeared before the deployment committee for approval, input, and sign-off on appointments. And what you see there is a meeting attended by the president to explain appointments to the SOE council. The committee's influence is not only wide across the state, it also drills deep down into our state institutions. At the top, you obviously have revelations regarding its influence on the deployment of judges to the Constitutional Court, the Supreme Court of Appeal, Labour Court, and High Court. You also have CEOs of state-owned enterprise boards, members of those boards, but then you also have deputy chairpersons and commissioners of Chapter 9 institutions that are supposed to be completely independent and subject only to the Constitution, like the Human Rights Commission. And on the other hand, you even have examples like the one I've put on screen here, of the ANC interfering in the appointment of mid-level bureaucrats like deputy directors general. So the influence is both wide and deep. Very clearly now we also have evidence, and this is really one of the most important things that comes out of this, is that public servants themselves account to the ANC's cadre deployment committee. Public servants are appointed to do exactly that, serve the public. They are supposed to be non-political appointees, professionals who implement the policies of the government of the day. But what we see here is one example of the Director General in the Department of Trade and Industry not only attending an ANC cadre deployment committee, but actually discussing appointments that are to be made in that specific portfolio. So this is something that we did not have evidence of before. We now know that the civil service, the people who are supposed to serve you, account to the ANC in the first place. We also see that it's not only a case of directors general or officials attending and accounting to the party. It's that the deployment committee issues instructions on the filling of vacancies and even the timing of those vacancies. One example from the minutes here shows that the ANC decided that there shouldn't be appointments of directors general 6 weeks before an election. A political consideration influencing a decision on whether to fill vacancies in the public service. You also see clear evidence that the ANC consults with and obtains information from public servants and officials in this specific case to get recommendations for cadres who should be deployed to foreign missions and boards. The interaction, therefore, and accountability from the state to the ANC extends far deeper than we ever thought before. Most importantly, perhaps of all, loyalty is a decisive criterion for appointment. Loyalty to the ANC, that is, not necessarily to the country. There are numerous explicit references to loyalty as a key factor in influencing appointments. You see one reference there to former Minister Edna Molewa having to add the names of an ANC cadre for an appointment. You see a reference there to the National Research Foundation Board lamenting the fact that political appointments are not allowed, but there seems to be a good team with a number of people associated with the ANC movement. Here you see a reference to the chair being a long-standing member of the ANC, and all the members of this particular board are from the ANC. A further recommendation to Minister Mbalula that out of 182 applications, he recommends 9 cadres. And also noting that a certain comrade, Derek Swartz, is a firm supporter of the ANC in justifying his appointment. Furthermore, the committee uses certain identity markers, including race, to make appointments in certain cases. It also includes gender and references to geographic origin. The problem here, of course, beside the fact that the ANC has no business influencing these appointments, is that some of this may amount to unfair discrimination. Look at the case of a certain Mr. Norge, who will be removed so that a white person with experience in the oceans economy will be placed. You can see also that there was a change made, presumably to a shortlist, on the recommendation of the ANC's Women's League, presumably to remove a man from that position so that a woman can be appointed on the basis of what was wanted by the ANC's Women's League. Importantly also, the ANC's Cadre Deployment Committee does not just make recommendations. There's been an attempt by certain ANC members to make this argument, but there are numerous instances in these minutes where it's clear that the committee amends proposals that came from the ministers. I've already shown you that in some cases it reserves the right to make certain appointments, and the committee's approval is repeatedly requested. And in some cases, it even scolds ministers for not following procedure, including the president, who had to apologize for making appointments to an advisory council without consulting the committee. The truth is that instead of the ANC's cadre deployment recommending and ministers appointing, it is often the other way around. Ministers make recommendations, and the ANC's cadre deployment committee decides who gets appointed to which job. Here are certain examples of that, where references to someone being allowed to make a decision, a change being made to a list, the president apologizing for making appointments, and recommended names being approved, but that changes must go to the committee. You also see Minister Pravin Gordhan here being scolded for not following the so-called correct procedure of informing the committee before any appointments are made, and a complaint in reference to the DTI department that certain appointments are quote-unquote a fait accompli, and that this is not the first time that the department failed to follow the correct procedure. If a department can scold ministers and force the President of the Republic to apologize for exercising legal powers, then you know the influence that that committee has. The ANC finally also runs a parallel CV database, whereby it gives cadres the inside track to appointments. We see references in specific cases where the names of cadres will be forwarded by the committee of cadres requesting deployment, and that the committee sometimes sends CVs also directly to the minister. The request for deployment is a standing item on most ANC cadre deployment committee meetings. And what this tells you is that there are people who approach not the state, not the appointing authority, not the minister or the SOE, but the ANC, a political party, and knows that that is the true avenue through which to get appointed to these positions. The minutes finally also confirm the existence of provincial and regional cadre deployment committees. We've known that in the ANC's cadre deployment policy there are references to these local committees, but here we have hard evidence, black on white, that this system, what we see here, is only a small part of the bigger picture of cadre deployment, which likely extends all the way through the provinces and all the way down into the municipality where you live, where officials are also appointed by such a committee. I've mentioned the 9 conclusions. I'll just run through that quickly. This committee is active. It has influenced appointments to 88 different state entities involving 29 ministers and deputy ministers. It does not only recommend, but it directly influences appointments across a very wide swath of state institutions, all the way from the courts to government departments. Its influence also goes very deep, and it's not only the top level, but also mid-level bureaucrats that get appointed through this committee. It primarily uses two mechanisms. The one is to propose specific names. The second one is to reserve certain positions for appointment by the committee. Fifth, it is not only ministers who account to this committee, but also public servants. Support, membership, and loyalty to the ANC is a clear consideration for appointment. In some cases, the committee discriminates on the basis of identity, like gender, race, and geographic origin when deciding on appointments. The committee manages a separate CV database to give cadres an inside track to appointment, and we know that there are provincial and regional deployment committees. What are the implications and the way forward? First of all, for the first time in 27 years, we have hard, concrete, solid evidence that cadre deployment not only exists, but that it continues unabated and that it influences almost every aspect of our state. We know that decisions are outsourced to a political party, not made in terms of legally defined appointment processes in some cases, and we have clear evidence that the interests of the party rather than the country are paramount in taking these decisions. The result is that skilled and professional people who apply in good faith for positions in the state, in SOEs and elsewhere, are discriminated against and locked out from appointment because cadres have a secret avenue where people in Luthuli House meet and decide who gets appointed. Cadre deployment is therefore the foundation of state capture, and it is the root of collapsing capacity in the state. And also, cadre deployment did not end when Jacob Zuma resigned. It continues unabated in the Ramaphosa administration, and because cadre deployment continues, state capture continues. We will not end state capture until we abolish cadre deployment. The current moment, I believe, gives us a historic window of opportunity to truly end this practice. And I want to emphasize, for all political parties, no political party should have a secret committee sitting somewhere and deciding who gets appointed to positions in the state that are not supposed to be political positions. That's why, as Siviwe mentioned, we have the End Cadre Deployment Bill before Parliament, and we will also continue with our court case against the ANC to get minutes dating back from before 2018, because between 2013 and 2018, none other than President Ramaphosa was the chairperson of the Cadre Deployment Committee. We now see how it operates. We can make lots of conclusions about how it must have operated during Ramaphosa's tenure as well to appoint the people who captured our state, but now our mission is to get hard evidence of that period as well. At the same time, this analysis and all the accompanying documents will be submitted to the Public Service Commission as a first step in combating this, where we'll be requesting the PSC to review all of these appointments. Where they're found to have been illegally influenced, those appointments must be redone, and that's a process that the DA will be closely monitoring. Thank you very much.
Thank you very much, Leon. And before I open the floor for questions, just to conclude, it's now clear that through the efforts of the DA, we have seen how deep cadre deployment has gone in our state institutions. We've also seen how it has gone on to affect the appointment of members of the judiciary. And so, as Leon has stated, we will be requesting a PSC investigation into particularly the public service appointments. And once the final report, as Glynnis has said, has been tabled, we will be ensuring that the recommendations are then carried out. We're also, from a parliamentary point of view, I'll be writing to the Speaker to request that a debate of public importance be scheduled as a matter of urgency in order for members of Parliament to table solutions to ending this kind of practice. We will also be making sure that we push the End Cadre Deployment Bill so that it can make sure that this kind of practice is abolished. As Glynnis said, we will also be making sure that at least by the end of the year, the Corruption Commission which is going to be far more independent and hopefully a lot more capacitated than the NPA will be in operation, or at least established, so that we can start to see prosecutions and actually start to see some people going to jail for this kind of hollowing out of our state institutions. And so, colleagues, I'm going to open the floor for questions. Are there any questions from the floor here before I move on to those virtually? To Glynnis and Leon, I'll just let you know which questions are directed to you. Okay.
Lula Mamaja, SABC. I just want to ask no from the DA if they don't have a similar thing like cadre deployment, even if you don't call it cadre deployment, but don't you also as a party deploy your people in strategic positions in the province, city, and local municipalities that you govern? Thank you.
Cool. Thank you, Lulama. There's another question here, Richard. Will you handle that here? Cool.
Yes, sure. I'm over covering from SABC Radio. So we came later, and when we're speaking, Glynnis, I've heard you, Siviwe, as well, talking about this corruption commission. If you can elaborate what would that entail,
okay,
specifically. And secondly, just to add up on my colleague's question, recently, former MEC for Human Settlement, I think, was not easier, has been touted as one who's going to be appointed, or one of the candidates to be appointed by the Premier and Minister as a special advisor. And that has been seen as part of the cadre deployment. Can you further elaborate and answer to that question? Thanks.
Cool. Glynnis, if you can handle the Corruption Commission, I think you will be able to answer both Lulama there and my colleague there. I think we're done in the room. Then I've got other questions. Rebecca Davis from Daily Maverick. As a member of the JSC, does Advocate Breytenbach caucus with the DA about judge candidates before JSC meetings and take these discussions into consideration when assessing the judge candidates? If so, is this much different to ANC members of the JSC receiving instructions from the cadre deployment meetings before the JSC meetings? So, Glynnis, on your side is the Corruption Commission and the JSC questions from Rebecca Davis. And then Linda Enso from Business Day. At what stage is the legal process to get hold of cadre deployment committee minutes from 2013 to 2018? So if you can just add that to your questions, Leon. And then we also got a question, what will the DA do to expedite arrests by the NPA? I think that will perhaps be covered by Glynnis's response to what the Corruption Commission will be about. All right, do you guys mind answering from the... Leon, can you take it away first? Thanks.
No, I hope this works. Can you hear me? Thanks. Okay, thank you for those questions. On the question of whether the DA has a cadre deployment committee, the answer is a simple and easy no, and we will never have one when we get into national government. In the case of Madikizela, that is obviously a question for the Premier to explain his thinking and the process, but what I do know is that, as I pointed out in the beginning of this presentation, there are certain political appointments that can be made in terms of advisors, in terms of Section 12A of the Public Service Act. Cadre deployment is not that. Cadre deployment is the appointment of ANC loyalists to positions in the public service, which is a legally defined part of our state, where public servants are supposed to be non-political and certainly not political advisors. So that is the important distinction to make there. Finally, at what stage is the effort to get the minutes from before 2018? We are hoping for a court date in February in that case. It's not been confirmed yet, but that's what we're hoping for. And certainly during this year, we'd like to get that case settled. And obviously, you know, the fact that we've managed to obtain this part of the story is very significant also for that, and we'd hope to be able to furnish you with the full picture dating back all the way to 2013 when the president was the chairman. Thank you, sir.
GB?
Thanks, sir. This thing doesn't do anything. As regards the Anti-Corruption Commission, it is envisaged that it would comply with the requirements that were, with the recommendations set out in the Glynnis Suite of Judgments. Glynnis Suite of Judgments arises from the dissolving of the Director of Special Operations, so the Scorpions, and it recommended that they be replaced by an independent body that had investigative and prosecutorial powers that stood separate from the South African Police Service and separate from the National Prosecuting Authority, that would possibly fit best in Chapter 9 of the Constitution, so it would have complete independence, that the head thereof would have complete security of tenure and would report directly to Parliament. So the Anti-Corruption Commission private members bill that we're currently working on deals with those specific issues, and we're trying our best to fit an Anti-Corruption Commission into those requirements. We hope to table that bill in certainly the first half of this year, preferably the first quarter, and to try and get that on the go, because it is in our view the only answer to dealing with corruption on a grand scale as we have it in South Africa. The National Prosecuting Authority is certainly not currently or in the foreseeable future going to be able to do that, having been completely hollowed out inter alia by cadre deployment. So that is what the Anti-Corruption Commission would envisage. With regards to the question about the JSC, I can happily say that I have never consulted with anyone in the DA about the judges and the interviewing of judges for the positions on courts benches around the country. At the JSC, you may well be sent there as a representative of a political party by the National Assembly, but you're sent by the National Assembly. You do not wear a political hat, neither are you supposed to, and it is not a party political institution. So I have not ever, not even on one occasion, discussed the shortlisted judges with members of the DA caucus with a view to getting some sort of instruction about who should be preferred and who not. It has not happened, and I can assure you it's not going to happen. When you can expect arrest by the NPA? Well, the NPA doesn't effect arrest, the South African Police Service does. But they do it, of course, in conjunction with the National Prosecuting Authority when they're ready to go to trial. So when we can expect results, Shamila Pretoria has said on the record late last year, and again I think early this year, that the National Prosecuting Authority is not in a position to prosecute all of the cases that arise from state capture at the moment. If we look at the capacity that the National Prosecuting Authority has, and the fact that their budget has been cut twice in 2 years, then we must accept that they're not going to be in a position to do so in the very short term, probably not even in the medium term. And so while they will get some cases into court, and one hopes that the investigative directorate, who has 3 years of time under its belt, has got one or two cases that are nearly ready for prosecution, and hopes they'll be in court this year, I don't think that you can realistically hope to see more than one or two or three such prosecutions this year. And these prosecutions will take time. There's no quick fix. And the many hundreds of very serious cases that we already know about that will arise further from the final Zondo report, one must expect. I see no light at the end of the tunnel for the National Prosecuting Authority or the South African Police Service being able to deal with those matters in the foreseeable future, bearing in mind their serious budgetary constraints. And so you must accept that the government, when they say they're going to put an end to corruption and they're serious about stopping corruption, are not walking the talk, because they're not placing either of these institutions in a position to do the job that they're required to do. Thank you.
Just a quick addition, Glynnis, from Jan Gerberg to News 24, asking whether the Anti-Corruption Commission proposed is in line with the proposed Public Procurement Commission in the Zondo Report.
It was certainly in some aspects overlap, and it will be meant to dovetail with that envisaged type of institution, but the Anti-Corruption Commission is a standalone anti-corruption commission that we hope to get the legislation through, and it will be a replacement for the DSO, but one hopes DSO 2.2, so an improvement on the DSO, having seen the vulnerabilities of the DSO and how it was dissolved, to place this institution in a position where it will not be that vulnerable to party political attack. Thank you.
Thank you. I think I've covered all the questions. There was only just one last question that, there are a couple coming more. The one question, when will you be asking the speaker for a debate, and what does a debate do in light of rank corruption? We will be writing to the Speaker of the National Assembly, Nosivuo Mapisa Ngakula, this afternoon, requesting that the Programming Committee prioritizes this debate of national importance. What is really important about a debate like this is that, firstly, all debates that happen in Parliament are a matter of public record. Number two, all the solutions that are proposed in a debate like this are solutions that we can place on the record, and they can always remain part of the public record. But also it means that Parliament becomes part of the solution to a problem like this. The reality is that this has been going on for many, many years, and Parliament has been, found wanting in terms of being at the forefront of solutions to issues facing South Africa. And so we can't simply be spectators as members of Parliament when this kind of practice is happening. We've got to make sure that we propose solutions, that South Africans are seeing us being united in trying to end corruption in this way. And so it's not a waste of time to have a public debate of this nature. It's provided for in the rules, and it's quite effective in terms of being able to table solutions to these kind of problems. And then the question to Leon from Rebecca Davis, do you have any figures on how often Cadre Deployment Committee succeeds in getting its preferred candidate appointment? It seems unclear from the minutes, as names are often not mentioned. And I thought there was one more from Richard, and then we will close the Q&A.
Clarity, you saying that the appointment of Bonfigosima Dikizela is for the Premier to explain. Is the DA distancing itself from that appointment? Secondly, the appointment of Kusum Zimbabwe, who is the ombudsman for the city of Cape Town. He was a DA MP in Parliament. He was appointed as an ombudsman in the city of Cape Town. Is that not a Cadre deployment? Thanks.
Cool. Thank you so much, Lulu. And so, Leon, I'm going to... perhaps, Leon, you can start with just explaining the distinction between the limited scope of political appointments,
yeah,
and the distinction between what cadre deployment is then. And then you can maybe then conclude by Rebecca's questions about that.
Sure. Thanks. So, the point of a cadre deployment committee, which does not exist in the Democratic Alliance, is to influence appointments to the state in order to advance the interests of that political party. So that is what cadre deployment is. It is a concerted and systematic effort to implement the wishes of the political party in the state. It does not exist in the Democratic Alliance. The appointment powers that the city or the premier has are legally defined, and they go through legally defined selection and appointment processes. That is exactly what is bypassed in the case of ANC cadre deployment. As you can clearly see in these minutes, the legally defined selection processes are overruled or bypassed or ignored, and then the wishes of the political party are carried out. The appointments that you refer to are appointments that were made, as far as I know, and I'm not in the provincial government, through the legally defined appointment processes. We cannot quibble with the outcome of every appointment process. What we can do is ensure that those processes are legally compliant and that they go through the correct selection criteria and that they are not bypassed through a shadowy political party committee that sits behind the scenes and changes and influences those decisions. That is what cadre deployment is, and that is what does not exist in the Democratic Alliance. In terms of the success rate, interesting concept of cadre deployment, that is exactly what we would like the Public Service Commission to now assist us with. We've analyzed what we have in the minutes, but we believe that we do have state institutions in this country that should be used, and the Public Service Commission is one of those that in the end cadre deployment bill actually would get significantly more powers to exercise oversight over appointments precisely to avoid cadre deployment and its attendant consequences. So we are turning to the Public Service Commission as our first step in actioning our resistance against the system, but it is very likely not to be the last step. And as Glynnis said, we are waiting for the final Zondo Commission report, hoping that there will be findings also about cadre deployment in the process, strengthening our hand and the hand of every person who wants a non-political and professional public service in South Africa.
Cool, thank you very much. I think just perhaps to add to your point, Leon, about political appointments. I think the DA has been very vocal about the fact that there can be no political appointments made in institutions that are meant to be independent. And we remain committed to that. And each and every one of our mayors, our premiers, understand that that is a value in the DA, that we will not put political appointments in institutions that are meant to be independent. And so if a political appointment has been made, it has to be in line with the law. And if it isn't, it is something we will never tolerate. And so that is why we're saying that the premier must explain the process, because we are confident that it will be in line with the law. However, that is something that the DA can never tolerate if there are political appointments that are made in independent institutions of the state, because we believe that's the very foundation of what we have, which is a state capture. And we cannot be the ones who are speaking against state capture while actually practicing the very thing. And so we're confident in saying that our public reps and our premiers and our mayors in government are well versed on understanding that our values do not include the practice of cadre deployment. And that's something that we will never, ever equivocate on. Thank you very much, colleagues. If there are no more questions, we will close the Q&A.
I need a clarity. Just some clarity. It's not a question. Alliance, how did you manage to get these minutes? Is it all part of the State Capture Commission or the first batch of the reports? Forgive my ignorance. Thank you.
No problem. So we initially submitted that PIA request to the State Capture Commission at the end of August, which was shortly after the President's testimony revealed that the Commission had these minutes. Initially, the Commission wrote to the ANC saying that we are considering making these minutes public. The minutes at that stage had not been made public. In other words, it was not put on the website like all the other materials were, and that's exactly why we had to PIA them. So there was actually quite a long back and forth of correspondence with the ANC saying it must not be made public and confidentiality and all kinds of things. And then ultimately, the Commission simply uploaded those minutes to its website. So it made them public as it did with all other documents, which is exactly what we asked for right from the start. But there was a bit of a to and fro. But you can find this full documentation online now as well.
Cool. Thank you very much, colleagues.
Thank you, children.